So this is a process by which, given a set of linearly independent vectors in an inner product space, so X is my inner product space. This is my inner product space. And I'm given some set of linearly independent vectors. So I have this set S, which comprises of which is a subset of X, and S corresponds to say x1, x2, and so on. I have given a subset of vectors in the inner product space. This could have finite number of vectors, it could have infinite number of vectors. Right now I am not worried about how many vectors are there in this set. They could be finite, they could be infinite. All that I know is that these vectors are linearly independent. These are linearly independent. But this is not an orthogonal set. S is not an orthogonal set. So S is not, what is an orthogonal set? The vectors are mutually orthogonal. You take any pair of vectors and find the inner product will be 0. So that is where you have a set to be called as orthogonal set. So this is not an orthogonal set, and I would like to generate an orthogonal set, because orthogonal sets are very, very useful when you do modeling, when you do applied mathematics, numerical computations. So how do I do that? I start by defining a unit vector. So E1, my E1 is going to be x1 divided by norm x1. Okay. Well, inner product defines a norm, so my norm x1 is nothing but 2 norm is nothing but inner product of x1 with itself, raised to half. So this is my first vector. This is a unit vector. I want to create a set. Starting from this set, I want to create a set which is not just orthogonal, but which is orthonormal. Okay? I want to create unit vectors. I want to create unit vectors which are orthogonal to each other. Okay? So this is my first vector. What I do next is, well, orthogonality allows us to split a vector into two components. One along a direction and one orthogonal to the direction. Okay, that is the concept which I am going to use in Gram-Schmidt process. So what is my first thing? First thing is I pick up now this vector x2 here. I pick up this vector x2 here, and then I create a vector z2 which is x2 minus x2 even, inner product of x2 even. So this gives me component of x2 along even, okay, times even. You can very easily check that this vector, and so if I define another vector, say v2, which is I have two components of vector x2, z2 and v2. Okay, this is one component, x2 minus v2 is another component. This is nothing but, see, this is what I am calling as v2. x2 minus v2 and v2. I am decomposing the vector x2 into two orthogonal components. It's very easy to check that inner product of v2 and z2 is equal to 0. V2 and z2, inner product is 0. Okay? Just substitute and find out. You will get inner product to be 0. Not at all difficult. These two are orthogonal components. I am splitting vector x2 Okay, so x2 is okay. So now what I do next? Well, I got two directions which are orthogonal. One is E1 and other is Z2. See, because V2 is just some scalar times E1, right? Some scalar times E1. So one direction is E1 and Z2. These are orthogonal to each other. And then I define E2, which is Z2 by norm Z2. Okay, so I got two directions, E1 here starting from the first vector, then I removed the component along E1 from x2, I created Z2, then I just normalized Z2 to create E2. Okay, so now there are two directions, E1 and E2, both of them are unit magnitude. This is a unit magnitude vector, right? Unit magnitude vector, and E1 and E2 are orthogonal. Okay, I just do this, you know, by induction. So I take x3, I remove component along E1 and E2, whatever remains I make it unit magnitude. I go to x4, I remove from E1, E2, E3, just go on doing this. So this process is called as so my next step would be, you know, define Z3, which is x3 minus x3 inner product E1, E1 minus x3 inner product E2, x3 inner product E2, E2. So this is my vector Z3. And then using Z3, I can define E3, which is Z3 by norm Z3, and so on. Okay. So given a set of vectors which are not orthogonal, I can just follow this systematic procedure to split, to create a set which is orthonormal, okay, and creation of this orthonormal set from a non-orthonormal set is called as Gram-Schmidt process. Okay, so now let's start today doing some things. Let's actually look at some examples and let's create some orthogonal sets starting from some non-orthogonal sets. Okay. Okay. So my first example is going to be in R3. My first example my inner product space is simply R3, and the inner product between any two vectors is simply x transpose y. Okay, simply x transpose y, and I am given three vectors, x1 which is 1, 1, 1, x2. Now, I want you to do this by hand. I want to start doing it. 1, minus 1, 1, and x3 is 1, 1, minus 1. Are these linearly independent? Are these three directions linearly independent in R3? These are linearly independent. Are they orthogonal? They are not orthogonal. You take inner product of any two, you will not get zero. So these are not orthogonal directions. I want to construct an orthogonal set starting from this non-orthogonal set. I want to apply this process. So just start doing this. What will be E1? E1 will be simply 1 by root 3, 1, 1, 1. What will be Z2? Just calculate. So we have to start with. So what is inner product of X2 even? What is this quantity? X2 is this vector. 1 by root 3. So what is the second vector? What is Z2? Will be 1 minus 1 1 minus 1 by root 3 times 1 by root 3 1 1 1. So what is this vector? Two-third minus four-third and two-third. So this gives you, so Z2 is, you said two-third minus four-third, two-third transpose, right? Okay, so this is my Z2. So what is E2? You have to help me with this. Two by 3 root 6 two-third minus 4 by 3 2 by 3. This is my E2. Just check whether E1 and E2 are orthogonal. What do you get? If you do E1 transpose E2, what do you get? Do you get 0? If you don't get 0, you have made a calculation error. You must get a 0 here if you take this inner product. And those who have done this, just go ahead to E3, compute E3. Does this turn out to be 0? It does. Just check. If you take inner product of this with E1, you should get 0 vector. Not 0 vector, 0 magnitude. Inner product should be 0. E1 transpose E2 should be 0. Perfectly 0. If you are not getting it, there is some error somewhere. Is it 0? I don't hear. Yes, clearly there's some. Yes, it's 0. Okay, what about next? What about X3? What about Z3? What is Z3? One, one, minus one. Then E1. What is inner product of X3 and E1? 1 by root 3. 1 by root 3 into 1 by root 3. 1, 1, 1. Then minus. What is the inner product here? 1 1 1. So what is the number that should appear here in the product? E2 with 2 by minus 2 by root 3 minus 2 by root 6. So this becomes 2 by root 6. Is that fine? Because there was, did we have a minus Is this correct? Is this minus correct? This is correct. What about here? This becomes plus. Does it become plus? Yeah. Is it fine? Okay. So what is this vector finally? Can somebody help me with this? What are these three numbers? Well, after you find this Z3, you have to make it unit magnitude. You have to divide it by its magnitude. But that's a simpler part. What will be? Has anyone completed? You tell me. This could be, I'm just writing here, I'm not doing the calculations, I'm just writing here, somebody is prompting me. So you have to tell me whether this plus is correct or minus is, should be minus here. Plus is correct here. So what is the total? 10 minus 1. See, our friend says 10 minus 1. Everyone agrees or there are some different calculations or? By the way, 10 minus 1, is this orthogonal to this and this vector? It seems to be, this 10 minus 1 is orthogonal to this vector, this direction. Forget about the multiplying factor. This direction is orthogonal to this. What about here? 1, 1, 1. Oh yeah, it is. So these are mutually orthogonal because this and this are orthogonal, this and this are orthogonal, this and this are orthogonal. So 10 minus 1 seems to be, I am not sure about the multiplying factor. Is that correct? 1 by root 2. Okay. E3 is 10 minus 1, Z3. So E3 becomes, E3 becomes 1 by root 2, 10 minus 1. So I started here with three vectors in R3, okay, which were not orthogonal, and then systematically I could construct set of three vectors which are unit magnitude orthogonal vectors. Okay, unit magnitude orthogonal vectors. So if you try to, you know, you have started with something like this in R3, three vectors which are, you know, linearly independent. Okay, let's say v1, x1, x2 and x3. Starting from this, what you have done is you have created a set which is orthonormal. Okay, you have created a set which is orthonormal starting from a set which was linearly independent but not orthogonal. Okay, so we had a situation like this, we moved to orthogonal set. Okay, that is what we have done. Now specific vectors that you get here will depend upon how you define the inner product. Okay, I just wanted to repeat one calculation. Well, subsequently all the calculations will change, but if I change my definition here of the inner product, okay, the subsequent calculations will change. The directions may not change in R3, but magnitude calculations can change. And I want to emphasize this one small thing. Is this clear? We started with a non-orthogonal set and we came up with three directions which are orthogonal to each other. Okay. So now let me just do one small change here. My second example is again R3. My second example is again R3, but I am going to change the definition of my inner product to X transpose WX, X transpose WY, where W is a symmetric positive definite matrix. I'm going to pick up one particular matrix here. I'm going to pick up this matrix W. Well, there are many ways you can pick up a symmetric positive definite matrix. Take a matrix which is simply diagonal elements which are positive. Okay, so that is one way. I'm going to pick this matrix 2, minus 1, 1. Is this a symmetric positive definite matrix? It's a symmetric matrix, that is for sure. Is it positive definite? Do you know a test for finding out positive definiteness? Eigenvalues. Any other test? Principal minors. This is greater than 0. 2 is greater than 0. Is this determinant greater than 0? This determinant is greater than 0. What about this determinant? All three put together. Calculate, is the determinant greater than 0? The simple algebraic test to find whether a matrix is positive definite or not. Look at these matrices constructed by, you know, first element and first 2 cross 2 matrix, then 3 cross 3 matrix. Is it positive? Okay. It's a simple test to find whether a matrix is positive definite or not. So this is a positive definite matrix, and X transpose WY will define an inner product on R3. This inner product is different from what we defined previously. Okay. So now just remember, what is our 2 norm? 2 norm is X, inner product X raised to half. So in this case, it will be X transpose WX raised to half. All their calculations will have to be done using X transpose W. So what will be the unit direction now? What is my first vector? What is the very first vector that you, what will be E1? E1 is X1 divided by norm X1. What is norm X1? So you have to work with 1, 1, 1 transpose this matrix. So norm x1 square is 2, minus 1, 1, minus 1, 2, 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, 2 into 1, 1, 1. So what is this quantity? One is 6. 2. This multiplication comes out to be 2. Square is 4. Yeah. So this comes out to be 4, and then square root of this is 2. Okay. So what is the direction? First direction? Yeah. The first direction then becomes, even becomes half 1, 1, 1. This is different from what we got earlier, right? Earlier we defined inner product in a different way. So the norm which was defined through the inner product was different, and the unit vector was different. With this definition of inner product, which, see, this definition of inner product here, X transpose WY, where W is a symmetric positive definite matrix, that induces a norm, two norm, the two norm of 111 using this definition of inner product turns out to be 2, 2 norm square is 4, right? And the unit vector, the direction is same, but the vector is different, right? The direction is same, the vector is different. Earlier we got 1 by root 3, 1, 1, 1, okay. Now I am getting 1 by 2. So, what I want to do is further, what I want to stress here is all further calculations will have to be done using this inner product. Do not forget this, okay. So, in the exam, if I give you a problem which has a matrix W, which is, see, earlier we had a special case, W was identity matrix 1, 1, 1, and okay. If I give you a different matrix W, you have to keep using that matrix every time you calculate inner product in that example, because R3 with this inner product is a different space, different inner product space than what with W is equal to I. R3 with W is equal to I and R3 with W is equal to this matrix are two different inner product spaces, okay. Calculations will be different, very, very important. Is this clear? I am not doing the further calculations, we will move on to some other example, okay. Well, now I want to graduate from finite dimensional spaces to infinite dimensional spaces, and then we will see how we start meeting some of the old friends that you have known in your undergraduate curriculum. So now inner product space is any set which satisfies certain axioms, right? And we have generalized the concept of inner product space. Now I am going to look at set of continuous functions. My inner product space is going to change, my inner product definition is going to change. So my third example, and this is where now you have to do some workout, okay? And you have to help me on the board and as to how do we come up with vectors which are unit vectors, okay. Then we start doing developing vectors which are orthonormal. We start with a non-orthogonal set and develop an orthogonal set, same idea, okay. Now my x is set of continuous functions over 0 to 1. My inner product space is set of continuous functions over intervals.